So we'll continue with the mathematics tools part two. So today we'll finish both this differentiation and integration. And apart from that, we have also created a Google Classroom for you guys, where we'll be uploading all the study material content. So for physics, I have made one Google Classroom where I'll be uploading the YouTube video. The video which I am taking right now, the class which I am taking right now, is always on a record mode, so that recordings are being put there on the YouTube, on the Google Classroom. And these slides which I use for the class, these are also converted into PDF and are being uploaded in the
Okay sir, thank you.
So in fact, we'll share the I'll share the Google Classroom thing today, so you can just log in there, and then you can accept the invite, and from there you can always look at all the study materials. Now, physical meaning of dy by dx. So we just before this we had discussed about what does differentiation means. So physical meaning of dy by dx, so dy by dx, the ratio of small change in the function y and the variable x is called the average rate of change of y with respect to x. So for example, if a body covers a small distance delta s in time delta t, then average velocity is given by delta s by delta t. So average velocity, we know that total distance traveled by total time taken. So that small distance which is covered is written as delta s, and the time interval is given as delta t. So average velocity is delta s by delta t. So this can also be, the average acceleration can also be written in this form, where average acceleration is small change in velocity by time interval. So if the velocity of the body changes by a small amount delta v in the small interval delta t, then average acceleration is delta v upon delta t. Now, when delta x tends to zero, so when I write delta y by delta x and delta x tending to zero, that means the limiting value of delta y by delta x, the limiting value of delta y by delta x is actually dy by dx. So we'll see the geometrical interpretation of this as well, and you will be more clear about what we are talking right now. So if you draw a curve, basically y is equal to fx curve. So let's say this is the curve. So at x is equal to x1 and at x is equal to x2, we have different values of y, suppose. So this is y, this is x, y-axis and x-axis. So this is, let's say, y1, y2. The values at x is equal to x1 is y is equal to y1, and at x is equal to x2, the value of y is y2. So if we find the difference, if I say, when I say delta y means y2 minus y1. And when I say delta x means x2 minus x1. So delta y upon delta x is basically, if we draw a chord, chord means a line joining A and B, line segment AB. This is a chord for this graph, for this curve. So the slope of this curve, slope of this chord is given as delta y by delta x. So slope of chord AB is given as delta y by delta x. Now, as you reduce the value of delta x, as you bring this x1, x2 closer, so the value of delta x will decrease. So as delta x will decrease, the value y also comes nearer to the point A. This B point comes nearer to point A. So when delta x tends to zero, this gap, this difference, when it is tending to zero, means almost zero, that means that B and A coincide with each other. When B and A coincide with each other, that means the chord converts into a tangent. So this tangent, the slope of this tangent, is basically known as the value dy by dx. So delta y upon delta x, limit of delta x tending to zero is given as dy by dx. And this is the geometrical interpretation of that. We'll see it also later on. So this, you have to remember that when we find the ratio of delta y upon delta x, where delta x tending to zero, that is basically equal to dy by dx. So differentiation of a function with respect to a variable implies the instantaneous rate of change of function with respect to that variable. So instantaneous velocity is given as limit delta t tends to zero, delta s by delta t or ds by dt, where s is displacement. So rate of change of displacement is velocity, which can also be written as ds upon dt. Rate of change of velocity is given as acceleration. So a is equal to limit delta t tends to zero delta v by delta t, which is actually equal to dv by dt. So these are mathematical operations basically, where we find the differentiation of a function. So if we differentiate displacement, we get velocity. If we differentiate velocity, we'll get acceleration. So this is the chart which you have to follow. So displacement, when you are differentiating it, it converts into velocity. And when you differentiate a velocity, you get acceleration. Okay, so displacement, velocity, and acceleration, this is how they are related. So you have to differentiate displacement to get velocity, and you have to differentiate velocity to get acceleration. Is this clear? Now these are certain theorems on differentiation which you need to remember. If you differentiate a constant, you will always get equal to zero. So differentiation of a constant value is zero, means differentiation of 4 with respect to time is equal to zero, because 4 is a constant value. Okay, differentiation. So if y is equal to cu is a function where c is a constant and u is a function of x, then what you do, you take jo bhi constant hota hai, that is taken outside. So if, when you are differentiating c into u, c is taken outside and nothing is done to it, c into, then u, which is a function of x, is being differentiated with respect to x. So dy by dx becomes c times du by dx. When you have a function which is sum or difference of different functions, then you can take the differentiation inside the summation sign. So let's say you have to differentiate y with respect to x. That means differentiation of this whole function u plus minus v plus minus w. These are independent functions. So when you bring this differentiation sign inside the bracket, each of these functions are separately differentiated. So u will be differentiated by x, plus minus v differentiated by x, plus minus w differentiated by x. Now y is equal to uv, where u and v are functions of x. So when you find a differentiation of u into v, so what happens is when you take it inside, so u times dv by dx, right? U, so this is the product of two functions. So when you see product of two functions, first you keep one function as constant and differentiate the other one. So u is kept constant and v is differentiated. And then plus of v is kept constant and u is differentiated. So u dv by dx plus v du by dx. Then you have next, this is known as, this formula is known as product rule. And this formula is known as quotient rule. Quotient rule is applied when you have two functions which are divided with one another. So when you find the differentiation of u by v, differentiation of u by v, you take v as constant, differentiate u with respect to x, minus of u is kept constant and differentiation of v with respect to x divided by square of the denominator, that is v square. So v du by dx minus u dv by dx divided by v square, this is known as quotient rule. Y is equal to x raised to the power n. So whatever the power of x that is taken outside multiplied with x raised to the power, power is subtracted by 1. So power is reduced by 1 and the original power is multiplied here. For example, if you have to differentiate x raised to the power 4 with respect to x, you will get x raised to the power 4's differentiation. See, yahan pe n kya hai? 4. The value of n is 4. So what you will write it as 4 into x raised to the power 4 minus 1. Right? So which becomes 4 into x raised to the power 3. So this is the differentiation of x raised to the power 4. The power comes and gets multiplied to the variable and the power is reduced by 1. So if it is 4, it becomes 4 minus 1. So this becomes 3. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, there are certain other formulas as well. So, these formulas are formula for differentiation of trigonometric functions. So, differentiation of sine x is cos x. Differentiation of cos x is minus of sine x. Tan x differentiation is sec square x. Cot x differentiation is minus cos x square x. Sec x differentiation is sec x into tan x. Cosec x differentiation is minus cosec x into cot x. Log x differentiation is 1 by x. E to the power x differentiation, e to the power x and e to the power ax differentiation is e to the power ax. And whatever the multiple of x, you know, whatever is multiplied to x, that is taken out and multiplied with the function itself. Okay. So the coefficient here is multiplied to the function. A times E times E into AX. So this is the formulas which you need to remember. There are certain more formulas which we have written. So X to the power N, this we have already discussed, NX N minus 1. Constant ka differentiation is 0. E to the power X differentiation is E to the power X. A to the power X differentiation is A to the power X log A to the base E. So this is a constant which is being multiplied to a to the power x. Differentiation of log x is equal to 1 by x. Differentiation of log x to the base a, to the base e is 1 by x. To the base a will be 1 by x log a to the base e. So again here, you can see that when a, e is replaced by a, we have log a to the base e. Here also e replaced by a, we have log a to the base e. Sin x differentiation is cos x, which we have already seen. Cos x differentiation minus sin x. Tan x ka differentiation sec square x. Cot x differentiation is minus cos x square x. Sec x differentiation is sec x into tan x. And cos x differentiation is minus cos x into cot x. So these are the formulas which you need to, you know, remember. Then you have a chain rule. Chain rule says that if y is differentiated with respect to x, where y is a function of u and u is a function of x, then we'll differentiate y with respect to u and then u with respect to x. For example, you have, let's say, sine of x square plus 2x. You have to differentiate this with respect to x. But we can see the value of the angle. Angle itself is a function of x. So what we can write is differentiation of sine of x square plus 2x. First we'll differentiate it with respect to x square plus 2x and then multiplied by differentiation of x square plus 2x with respect to x. Okay. So see, y ko humne u ke respect mein differentiate kiya. So sine of this whole thing with respect to the angle itself, this whole thing.
and then sine of that angle with respect to x, because that angle itself is a function of x. So this is known as chain rule. We have created a chain kind of thing. So the value of this will be differentiation of sine theta with respect to the whole angle theta is cos theta. So this will be cos of x square plus 2x into differentiation of x square plus 2x. We know that x square ka differentiation is 2x and 2x ka differentiation is 2. So you can see here differentiation of x square plus 2x can be written as differentiation of x square plus differentiation with respect to x and differentiation of 2x with respect to x. Now we know that differentiation of x square will be n into x raised to the power n minus 1, 2 into x raised to the power 2 minus 1 plus differentiation of 2x. So 2 is taken outside, differentiation of x with respect to x. So 2 into x raised to the power 2 minus 1 is 1 plus 2 into differentiation of x with respect to x is 1. So this is 2x plus 2. This is what we have found here. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
So geometrical meaning of differentiation, this we were discussing earlier also. So when we have, let's say, we have two points P and Q on this curve. This curve is the graph of the function y is equal to fx. Let's say this is the curve which is the graph of the function y is equal to f of x. Now, when you increase x by amount delta x, we reach here, and y by delta y, we reach here. So the value of the coordinate here is x plus delta x, comma, y plus delta y. So these are the two coordinates, x and y coordinates of the point Q. And coordinates of point P is x comma y, right? So this distance is delta x and this distance is delta y, right? When I say the average rate of change of y with respect to x, that is delta y by delta x, which is equal to tan theta, perpendicular by base becomes tan theta, which is equal to slope of secant PQ. Okay. So slope of secant. Why secant? Why? Because this is, you know, increased on both the sides. If it would have been ending at P and Q on the curve, then we would have called it chord. So slope of secant PQ is the average rate of change of y with respect to x. Now, if we decrease the value, right, if we keep on decreasing the value of delta x, so if we decrease the value of delta x, pehle yahan pahunche, phir we reached here, and then we reached here, then we reached here, and so on, and then we reached here. So as we decrease the value of delta x, the point Q comes nearer to P, and when delta x tends to zero, point P and Q coincide. So when point P and Q coincide, that means that this secant has now become a tangent. So the slope of the tangent at point P gives you instantaneous velocity. So if it is a displacement time graph, so it will be the instantaneous velocity when I say slope of point, slope of y with respect to x is called instantaneous velocity. Is it clear? Now we have maximum and minimum value of a function. So maximum and minimum value. So this is the maximum value here, and here we have the minimum value. At both these maximum and minimum value, what you observe is that tangent is parallel to x-axis.
Now, because the tangent is parallel to x-axis, so at both these points, you will observe that dy by dx becomes equal to 0. The slope becomes equal to 0. So whenever you have to find the maximum or minimum of a function, what you do is find the value of dy by dx and find the points where dy by dx becomes 0. Okay. So you will observe that at the points of maximum and minima, first derivative, that is dy by dx, becomes equal to 0. Now let us talk about the second derivative. So d2y by dx square. So if dy by dx is 0 and d2y by dx square is greater than 0, then we say that it is a condition of minima. Okay. And when dy by dx is equal to 0 and d2y by dx square is less than 0, then we have a condition of maxima. So it is just opposite. If it is greater than 0, it is minima. If it is less than 0, it is maxima. Okay. So this test is called second derivative test. So this is the second derivative test. So what we do is first we check whether dy by dx is equal to 0 or not. If you have dy by dx 0, you check d2y by dx square. If d2y by dx square is greater than 0, you will have minima. If it is less than 0, we will have maxima. So maxima, if you see here, so these are stuff which is not so much needed. Now we'll do integration. Yeah, Betsy, now is it okay? You are able?
Yes, sir. Yes, now.
So, integration. So, in integral calculus, the differential coefficient of a function is given. So, we are required to find the function. That is, the integration is basically the summation. So, what happens? Here, already differential coefficient is given, and you have to find the original function. For example, let's say what is given is differentiation of fx with respect to x. This is given as f dash x. So this is already given f dash x. You have to find the original function fx. So what you do is you do the integral of f dash x with respect to dx. You will get the original function. So integration is just the reverse of differentiation. Okay. So when you have to get the original function, you already know the differential value. That means you need know the differentiation, the function which you have got after differentiation. If you integrate that function, you will get the original function. Okay. So that's why it is called, the converse of, inverse of differentiation is integration. So this is the sign for integration. And basically this is the summation. So summation of discrete values, when it is a continuous function, then you replace summation by integration sign. So if I is the integration of a function and I is fx dx integral, so that means when you differentiate this integral function, you will get original function fx. Now, let us proceed. So for example, there are certain examples which you need to understand. If you have to integrate x raised to the power n with respect to x, here you will have x raised to the power n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 plus of some constant c. Now, why constant is because when you differentiate this value, you will always get x to the power n, right? So differentiation of a constant gives 0, and that's why a constant is always added when you integrate. This constant is known as arbitrary constant. So this constant just tells you that if you have, let's say, x cube plus 3 and you have another thing x cube plus 4, if you differentiate this or this, differentiation of both of this will give you only 3x square. So that means that plus 3 and plus 4, both when we integrate 3x square, you can either get this or anything. So that's why when we integrate a function, we write plus of some constant c, which we don't know about initially. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So these are certain functions, certain formulas. So these are
sir, all formulas will not be used, right?
So these trigonometric ones and the algebraic ones will be used. So we have when I discuss only those formulas which are useful to you.
Okay.
So x raised to the power n, when you integrate, you will get x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1. Most of the times you only come across algebraic function as well as trigonometric function. Only these two functions are there. And at times you will also come across these exponential functions and logarithmic functions. So these are the four functions which you will come across most of the time. So when we integrate this x raised to the power n, you will have a value x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1. For example, if you have x to the power 4 and you integrate it, you will get x to the power 4 plus 1 divided by 4 plus 1. So this will become x to the power 5 by 5. Similarly, when you integrate sin x, you will get minus of cos x plus c. Integrate cos x, you will get sin x plus c. Integrate 1 by x, you will get log x to the base e plus c. Integrate e to the power x, you will get e to the power x plus c. So these are all formulas for integration. So we have already seen these basic formulas. The difficult one we know didn't need to do. Now definite integrals. Definite integral is basically where you put the limits as well. So let's say I have to integrate x cube plus 3x square plus 2x plus 4. We have to integrate this function with respect to x. And the limits here is, let's say 1, 2, 3. That means the lower limit of the integration is 1 and upper limit is 3, and we have to integrate this. So when you bring the integration sign inside, you will have 1, 2, 3 x cube dx plus 3 is constant, can be taken out. 1, 2, 3 x square dx plus 2 is a constant taken out, x dx, 1, 2, 3, plus 4 dx, 1, 2, 3. So this is equal to x cube can be integrated as x to the power 4 upon 4. Limit here is 1, 2, 3, plus 3 times x square is integrated as x cube upon 3 plus of x is integrated as x to the power 2 by 2 and 4 is integrated, 4 dx means 4 is constant, can be taken out. Dx is x, so 4x, 1, 2, 3. So now you put the limits here. So how do you put limit is upper limit minus lower limit. So you can see f of b minus f of a. So once you will substitute the value of b and then you will substitute the value of a. So upper limit minus lower limit. So that means 3 raised to the power 4 minus 1 raised to the power 4 divided by 4 plus 3 into 3 cube minus 1 cube by 3 plus 2 into 3 square minus 1 square by 2 plus 4 into 3 minus 1. Okay. We don't have space here, so I'll just write it here also. So 3 to the power 4 is 81 minus 1, that is 80 by 4, plus 27 minus 1 is 26. This 3 and this 3 cancels. So we have 26. Plus this 2 and this 2 gets cancelled. So you will get 9 minus 1 is 8. Plus 4 into 3 minus 1 is 2. 4 2s are 8. And this also becomes 20. So when you add each of these, 8 plus 8, 16 plus 6, 22 and 20, 42 and 20, 62. So the answer is 62 here. Is it clear? You've understood the meaning?
Yes, sir.
Now, area under a curve and definite integration. So, area under a curve, let's say, what does definite integration mean, you know, geometrically? So, when you have to find a definite integration geometrically, here. So, this is basically the area under this curve. So, y is equal to fx. If we are writing, we have a function y is equal to fx and we are integrating y dx from a to b. So that means fx dx ka integral from a to b. So this is basically area under the curve y is equal to fx. So this is area under this curve. Starting from x is equal to a to x is equal to b. So this whole area is basically the integral of fx dx. Okay. So fx dx when I write, see this value, the value at x, the value of y is fx. So when I say fx into dx, that is basically the area of this rectangle, thin strip of rectangle. So when you divide this whole area into many such rectangles, and then when you add these rectangles, add the area of this rectangle, you will get the whole area which is under the curve. So integration, as we know, is the meaning of integration is summation. So summation of all the areas which lie between the function y is equal to fx and x axis, between the coordinates x is equal to a to x is equal to b. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now what we'll do, certain examples as well. So that your differentiation and integration becomes. So let's say we have to differentiate 4x cube plus sin x plus tan x. This is a function, let's say. We have to differentiate this function. Y is equal to 4x cube plus sin x plus tan x. We have to find the differentiation of this. So when you differentiate this dy by dx, what you will do is you will differentiate d upon dx, differentiate the whole function 4x cube plus of sin x plus of tan x. So when you are differentiating this whole function, you take this differentiation sign inside the bracket. So you will individually differentiate all these terms. Individually differentiate the terms separately and then add them together. So differentiation of 4x cube with respect to x plus differentiation of sin x with respect to x plus differentiation of tan x with respect to x. When you differentiate 4x cube with respect to x, 4 bahar ho jayega, differentiation of x cube with respect to x plus differentiation of sin x with respect to x. Sin x ka differentiation we know is cos x and tan x ka differentiation is sec square x. These are the formulas. So this is equal to 4 times differentiation of x cube means 3x square. So we know that differentiation of x raised to the power n with respect to x is equal to n into x raised to the power n minus 1. Whatever is the power that comes outside, and n into x raised to the power n minus 1. So this becomes 4 into 3x square plus, we already have differentiated these parts, cos x and sec square x. So 4 threes are 12x square plus of cos x plus of sec square x. So this is the differentiation of the function. Is it clear? Now let's take another question. Let's say we have to differentiate e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1 with respect to x. So let's say this is the function. So dy by dx, differentiation of e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1. Now we have to differentiate this function. So this again is a function of function basically. We know that we have a formula for e to the power x, but we don't have a formula for e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1. So we'll do it one by one. Okay. So differentiation of, so we'll use chain rule here. Okay. So the concept which we are going to use here is chain rule. So differentiation of e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1 with respect to 3x square plus 2x plus 1 into differentiation of 3x square plus 2x plus 1 with respect to x. So this is what is chain rule. Now differentiation of e to the power anything with respect to that whole quantity will be e to the power that quantity only. So e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1 into differentiation of 3x square plus 2x plus 1 with respect to x. So when we take it inside, we know that 3 times differentiation of x square with respect to x plus 2 times differentiation of x with respect to x plus differentiation of 1 with respect to x. E to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1 into 3 times differentiation of x square 2x ho gaya plus 2 times differentiation of x 1 ho gaya plus differentiation of 1 is 0. So e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1 into 6x, this whole thing is inside a bracket, 6x plus 2.
So this becomes 6x plus 2. This is multiplied to e to the power 3x square plus 2x plus 1. So this is the differentiation. Is it clear? Let's do another example. We'll do it for integration now, let's say. Let's say we have to integrate a function sine x plus cos x plus 3x square plus 2x plus 1. We have to integrate with respect to x. So we can take the integral sign inside. So we'll get sine x dx integral plus integral of cos x dx plus 3x square dx plus 2x dx plus of 1 dx is dx. So when you integrate each of these, sine x, the integration of sine x is minus of cos x. Integration of cos x is plus of sine x. Integration of 3x square, we take 3 outside. X square ka integration, x to the power 3 by 3. Plus 2 times x ka integration is x square by 2. And dx ka integration is x. So now 3 and 3 gets cancelled, 2 and 2 gets cancelled. So the final answer is minus of cos x plus of sine x plus of x cube plus of x square plus of x. So this is the integration of sine x plus cos x plus 3x square plus 2x plus 1. Is it clear? Now let's say we have to integrate, let us suppose sine x. So we have to integrate sine x plus cos x. And we have to integrate from 0 to pi by 4. The limit is 0 to pi by 4. So this is an example of definite integration. So what we'll do, we'll take the integral sign inside the bracket. So we will get sine x dx 0 to pi by 4 plus cos x dx 0 to pi by 4. When you integrate it separately, so we know that sine x integration is minus of cos x. So minus cos x, limit 0 to pi by 4, plus cos x integration is sine x, limit 0 to pi by 4. We know that we put the upper limit and then subtract it with the lower limit. So we have minus of cos of pi by 4, right? Minus lower limit means minus of cos of 0 degree plus sine of pi by 4 minus sine of 0.
minus cos pi by 4 means minus 1 by root 2. Cos pi by 4 is 1 by root 2. Negative sign is outside. So minus of 1 by root 2. Minus and minus becomes plus. Cos 0 is 1. Sin pi by 4 is 1 by root 2. Minus sin of 0 is 0. So minus 1 by root 2 plus 1 by root 2 gets cancelled. Answer is 1. Are you understanding, Betsy? Is it clear? Is it clear to you?